Point number three, statement by the President. I would like to welcome you all to this plenary session. We are just 10 days after the European Parliament election, which coincided with local and regional elections in many of our countries. So I have few announcements to make in this part of our meeting. So in June the 14th, our colleague Karsten Unu Petersen was elected chair of the Core NAT Commission by the NAT Commission member. This change follows the resignation presented by the former NAT chair Isilda Gomes, who will take her seat at the European Parliament. So I would like to thank Mrs. Gomes and also Mr. Petersen for their work. As of April the 30th, Jean-Luc Van Rees, member of the UCLA Municipal Council, was appointed as one of the COR representatives in the Fit for Future platform. And accordingly, as one of the Brass G members representing that component. Yesterday, the COR Bureau appointed Luca Menezzini as COR representative to the Interinstitutional Body for Ethical Standards and Ellen Nauta von Morsel as the alternative representatives. The Bureau also adopted the draft calendar of the COR Bureau meetings and, of course, of the plenary sessions of 2025. So the commissions will now work on setting also their dates for next year. Ladies and gentlemen, point number four, statements by political groups and a debate about the results of the European elections. It has been agreed by the political groups that this point of our agenda will only have statements by the political group's presidents. But let me, before giving the floor to the first intervenient, let me just congratulate not only all of those who were elected for the next legislature of the European Parliament, and especially those who are current or former members of the COR and now take their seats at the European Parliament. We will have in the next term some very tough and demanding challenges in the European Parliament. The discussion and the debate about the next MFF, multi-annual financial framework, the debate about the future of cohesion policy, the enlargement, all of this brings a big responsibility to the members of the European Parliament, but I am sure that they lived up to the task, and we will have a term very interesting, very fertile, and with very significance from the political point of view. Between current and former members of the COR, there are more or less around 30 new MEPs in the European Parliament. That's a good number. And this brings to me an invitation to all of them, so they can constitute what is called in American politics a caucus. And I think it will be very, very interesting. You can call it the Cohesion Caucus, for example. That would be useful. But nevertheless, wish them, that's what I would like to do right now, wish them all the luck, good work for the benefit of Europe, its cities, its regions, its member states. Ladies and gentlemen, now it is my pleasure to give the floor to our colleague, Olgier Gleblevich, for a statement, 4 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. President. Dear colleagues, of course, as a EPP political family, we are happy, we are proud that once again we are a leading political force in Europe. But we all know in this room that politics is not about a happiness, that politics is about taking responsibility and about leading Europe according to expectations of our citizens. And it is the moment when we need to ensure people of our communities that we are able to deliver security, prosperity, and good prospects for next generations with all responsible political forces in Europe. We are obliged to do it also because of the fact that one of the biggest winners of those elections is European democracy, with turnout of over 51%. In one third of member states, elections happened at the national, regional and local level. We regional and local leaders have contributed immensely to campaign for the European elections. We are without doubt a building block of European democracy, and we cannot let our people down. That's why I believe our effort should focus on the following. We need to keep cohesion policy high on the political agenda as a tool to make the European idea more visible and allow the EU solidarity to reach each village, city and region in EU. Speaking of solidarity, we should maintain our strong support for those regions and cities in the EU neighborhood who subscribe our common European values. We should work for better coordination of European politics in pre-legislative and legislative phase to involve regional and local actors as well as other impacted groups from our communities. By this, we will work to reduce administrative burden of new EU legislation, bring its objective in line with our needs, and make EU policies more legitimate. We, regional and local authorities and the COR, are the doctors that can cure geographic discontent, which we saw during those elections. We have instruments such as territorial impact assessments, subsidiary checks, and rural proofing. We can even bring actions before European Court of Council, and we should not hesitate to use them if necessary. The needs of cities and regions should be part of any future environmental, energy, and climate strategies and funding. Last but not least, as a member of the COR, we have a duties to explain the better regulations to citizens that EU delivers and can deliver for them. Communicating daily on the ground and using our networks of EU councillors and young elected politicians should be our priority. Dear colleagues, EPP Group has transmitted those common objectives in the political priorities of our EPP electoral manifesto and also personally to our EPP candidate for a post of President of the European Commission. We will now insist that the next President of the European Commission and the College of Commissioners, as well as the new European Parliament, deliver on those priorities. During this next mandate, we will be there to support, to assist, to criticize if necessary, but mainly to act. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Now the floor goes to Mr. Rouillon. Vous avez la parole pour 4 minutes.
Merci, Président. Merci, cher Vasco. Le constat que l'on peut faire après les élections européennes, c'est tout d'abord l'importante participation à ce scrutin, contrairement à ce qui a pu être annoncé. Et là, on peut se satisfaire collectivement, car nous avons tous plaidé pour une participation massive à ces élections. Alors, certes, avec des différences, ce qu'il faut aussi noter, c'est que on se rend compte que plus le niveau d'intégration sociale ou le niveau d'études est élevé, et plus les gens votent. Et il y a aussi une partie de l'électorat européen qui, malheureusement, fait encore sécession et n'a pas compris l'enjeu des élections européennes. Le deuxième point, c'est de se satisfaire que par rapport aux élections précédentes, plus aucun parti aujourd'hui ne demande la destruction de l'Union européenne, la sortie de l'euro ou la sortie de l'Europe. Ça, c'est quand même une évolution qui est à la fois positive et on se rend compte que au-delà de la progression d'un certain nombre de partis extrémistes, ce sont les partis qui sont les plus pro-européens qui l'ont emporté et cela est reflété au sein du Parlement européen avec un groupe PPE en première position et un groupe socialiste en deuxième position. Mais la nuance, c'est que parfois on se rend compte que certains partis, je veux partir des plus radicaux comme celui de l'extrême droite française ou l'extrême droite allemande, rentrent au sein de l'Union européenne non pas pour en sortir, mais pour la détruire de l'intérieur. Et c'est finalement peut-être encore plus dangereux. Il faudra avoir une très très grande vigilance dans les semaines qui viennent. Donc effectivement, nos thèmes de prédilection ont été affirmés par nos différents groupes politiques, mais je regrette que souvent ce ne soit pas ces thèmes qui aient été mis en avant, comme celui du logement, comme celui de la transition énergétique, de la politique agricole commune, des questions sociales, mais que ce soit parfois des questions de politique intérieure qu'il ait emporté. Donc nous avons un vrai travail d'influence auprès des parlementaires européens. Heureusement, certains auront été élus. Ce seront effectivement nos alliés au sein du Parlement dans cette enceinte. Il n'y a qu'une passerelle entre le Comité des régions et le Parlement européen. J'espère que les députés européens seront capables d'affranchir dans les deux sens pour à la fois nous apporter des informations aussi pour relayer nos positions. Et je terminerai en disant qu'il y a encore beaucoup de travail à faire, en particulier gagner les élections en France face à l'extrême droite pour éviter que Bardella, qui a des positions pro-Poutine, anti-européennes, soit demain à la tête du gouvernement français, ce qui aurait des conséquences dramatiques pour nos institutions, et également demain de se battre pour travailler sur le terrain avec des dialogues citoyens du Comité européen des régions. Également utiliser tous les moyens de communication numérique avec encore plus d'efficacité parce que parfois on ne va pas sur certains réseaux comme en particulier TikTok, hein, et à juste titre, mais ce sont des instruments de propagande anti-européenne contre des empires ou des pays qui veulent détruire nos valeurs et pratiquer la désinformation. Et également, il va falloir que demain nous réfléchissions à une façon aussi d'avoir peut-être plus de débats politiques européens, avec peut-être des listes aussi transnationales qui permettront de mieux voir l'enjeu européen à l'occasion des prochaines élections. Ce sera peut-être la bataille que l'on a, et de réfléchir aussi à l'augmentation du rôle politique de notre Assemblée, qui n'est pas un comité, mais qui est une véritable Assemblée politique, qui devra porter des positions à la fois sur nos valeurs, sur nos principes, sur le développement économique social, sur les investissements locaux, sur la politique de cohésion territoriale, qui permet de remettre des services publics en ville et à la campagne, et également de mettre en place les investissements dont les territoires ont besoin dans le domaine de l'innovation, de la recherche, de la transition énergétique et également de la protection du climat. Voilà, il y a beaucoup de choses devant nous. Il faut se battre. Never give up. Vive l'Europe. Et on va continuer à se battre pour défendre nos positions. Merci.
Thank you. Now the floor goes to our member François de Coster. Vous avez la parole pour 3 minutes.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, mes chers collègues. Voilà donc de nouvelles élections européennes et quand je dis cela, je mesure combien malheureusement ce sont encore trop souvent 27 élections nationales. Les sujets européens ont été encore trop peu présents dans les débats qui ont accompagné les réflexions de nos concitoyens sur ces élections. Il faudra encore davantage européaniser ces élections. Et nous avons, lorsque nous participions à la conférence sur l'avenir de l'Europe, fait des propositions. Et Christophe Rouillon vient d'évoquer notamment celle des listes transnationales. C'est l'une des propositions qu'il nous faudra encore accompagner pour qu'elle puisse devenir une évidence. C'est bien sûr une participation en hausse, a été évoquée par mes deux prédécesseurs. Nous devons nous en réjouir parce que pour la deuxième fois consécutive, la participation aux élections européennes est plus importante qu'aux élections précédentes. Je me réjouis aussi du fait que Eh bien, contre certains pronostics ou certaines études, la majorité sortante du Parlement européen reste majoritaire. Nous avons entendu souvent des études annoncer une victoire acquise d'avance par les souverainistes ou les ennemis de l'Europe. Ils ont échoué, et c'est le premier enseignement de ces élections européennes. Notre groupe y contribue, permettant d'assurer cette majorité au sein du Parlement européen avec d'excellents résultats dans un certain nombre de pays, comme en Irlande, au Portugal, en Slovaquie, en Autriche, en Bulgarie ou en Belgique. Mais je veux le dire, ce moment de démocratie européenne doit être aussi un moment pour le Comité européen des régions. Nous sommes un acteur majeur de la démocratie européenne et nous devons saisir ce moment pour accroître notre visibilité au sein des institutions européennes, comme nous le faisons au sein de nos territoires, de nos communes, de nos régions. Je formule donc trois propositions. Faire en sorte que nous puissions développer, renforcer toujours le réseau des conseillers locaux Union européenne, la future fusion avec le réseau lancé par la Commission européenne BELC au 1er janvier étant cela un moment important, il faudra y prendre toute notre place. Je vous rejoins, Monsieur le Président, dans l'animation d'un caucus de députés européens qui ont été des membres du Comité européen des régions. C'est une proposition que j'avais aussi formulée à notre conférence des présidents. Merci de l'avoir reprise. Et puis, troisièmement, je crois que nous devons être présents dans les auditions des futurs commissaires. Nous ne pouvons pas être absents, nous ne pouvons pas avoir le même rôle que le Parlement européen, mais pour 50% des propositions de la Commission européenne, elles transitent par chez nous. Et donc, nous devons avoir une interaction avec les candidats futurs commissaires.
Thank
pour
you.
Au moins ces domaines dans lesquels nous avons une voie consultative obligatoire. Je vous remercie.
Thank you so much. Now the floor goes to member Marco Marsilio for 2.5 minutes.
Grazie Presidente. I risultati delle elezioni europee di 10 giorni fa dimostrano chiaramente che gli elettori in Europa hanno premiato forze politiche conservatrici e patriottiche. Questo risultato storico dimostra nello stesso tempo che le istituzioni europee sono state per troppo tempo sorde agli appelli che abbiamo ripetutamente fatto perché si cambiasse passo. Per anni abbiamo quasi da soli denunciato le scelte ideologiche legate a un Green Deal che si è applicato come programmato, peraltro prima dell'emergenza Covid e prima della guerra in Ucraina, porterà alla desertificazione industriale del nostro continente e a nuovi costi per i nostri cittadini, che soprattutto i più deboli non potranno sostenere. Abbiamo chiesto a gran voce di usare tutti gli strumenti a disposizione per fermare l'immigrazione illegale e clandestina, che sta portando gravi problemi sociali e di sicurezza nel nostro continente e alimenta le mafie delle tratte di esseri umani dal continente africano in particolare. Soprattutto abbiamo promosso e continueremo a farlo il nostro modello di un'Europa confederale che rispetti i principi di sussidiarietà e proporzionalità, essendo contraria ad un costante accentramento di poteri a Bruxelles per ridurre la sovranità degli Stati membri. Possiamo dire con orgoglio che a partire dall'Italia gli elettori europei hanno ascoltato la nostra voce e hanno premiato i partiti conservatori uniti nell'ECR Party, presieduto dal Presidente del Consiglio italiano Giorgia Meloni. Tra i grandi paesi europei l'Italia è l'unica al cui governo è stato premiato dagli elettori, mentre in Germania non prende neanche il 30%, in Francia devono indire elezioni anticipate e in Belgio va in crisi il governo nazionale. Milioni di cittadini europei chiedono un'Europa che faccia meno cose e le faccia meglio, meno ideologia e più rispetto per i nostri agricoltori, veri custodi della sovranità alimentare, meno burocrazia, più crescita, meno dirigismo climatico, più neutralità tecnologica, meno importazioni di macchine elettriche cinesi a basso costo e più tutela della sovranità tecnologica, industriale ed energetica europea, meno ideologia gender, più rispetto dei valori cristiani che sono alla base della nostra civiltà europea. Le elezioni ci trasmettono un messaggio chiaro. Gli elettori vogliono un cambiamento, vogliono voltare pagina e lasciarsi alle spalle le follie dell'ultima legislatura. È ora che l'Unione faccia ciò per cui è sempre stata pensata, servire gli interessi dei cittadini.
Thank you so much. The floor goes now to member Karl von Looy for 2 minutes.
Thank you, President. Colleagues. 10 dagen terug kenden we in de Europese Unie een van de grootste democratische testen van de wereld. Met zo'n 400 miljoen kiesgerechtigden was afgelopen verkiezing de grootste transnationale verkiezing ter wereld. Naast het recht op verdediging van onze normen en waarden op Europees, nationaal en regionaal niveau, blijft de mogelijkheid, het recht om te gaan stemmen, een fundamenteel recht dat we moeten blijven koesteren in Europa, maar ook erbuiten. Nu er is gestemd en de vele analyses van de resultaten worden gemaakt, is er alvast één zaak waar iedereen het over eens is. Namelijk dat iedere stem wel degelijk telt. In mijn land was dat meer dan ooit duidelijk. Mijn partij had tegen de verwachtingen in een veel beter resultaat en we zagen een enorm verschil tussen wat de peilingen voorspelden en hoe de burgers uiteindelijk stemden. Meer dan ooit is duidelijk dat de burgers zijn die de uitslag bepalen, niet de peilingen, niet de opiniemakers, evenmin de social media. Op Europees niveau zien we jammer genoeg dat de verkiezingen voor vele burgers een ver van ons bedshow blijven. Met slechts een gemiddelde opkomst van 51% is het urgent om met programma's te komen die burgers overtuigen om effectief te gaan stemmen en duidelijk hun overtuiging tot uiting te brengen. Een goede start hierbij zou zijn dat partijen een regionale focus hanteren en zich focussen op de zaken die betrokken zijn waar de burgers zeer nauw bij betrokken zijn. Tot slot moeten we de vraag stellen, wat moeten we doen met ons politiek mandaat? Zal de Europese Commissie eindelijk het belang van de regio's omarmen in het besluitvormingsproces? Zal deze instelling op een structurele en gerichte wijze haar input kunnen geven aan het Europees Parlement en zal er ook rekening mee gehouden worden? Voor mijn fractie is het alvast duidelijk, de EU moet zich focussen op subsidiariteit in een Unie van, door en voor de regio's.
Thank you so much. The floor goes to member Nina Hattilainen for 2 minutes.
Kiitos puheenjohtaja. Minun kaupunkini on hiilineutraali vuonna 2029, seuraavan alkavan europarlamenttikauden lopussa. Miten monella kaupungilla meillä on tavoitteita, jotka pitää saavuttaa tämän europarlamenttikauden aikana? Tavoitteita liittyen hiilineutraaliuteen, luontokadun torjumiseen, köyhyyden vähentämiseen. Meidän kaupungeille tärkeitä politiikka-aloja käsitellään tällä europarlamenttikaudella. Ilman niitä emme saa omia tavoitteitamme läpi. EPP:n puheenvuorossa kysyttiin, kuuluuko onnellisuus politiikkaan. Minusta se kuuluu sillä tavalla, että olen itse nähnyt omassa kaupungissani, miten olemme ennätysmäärän kasvihuonepäästöjä vähentäneet ennätyksellisen paljon. Samalla työllisyys on kohentunut, talous on kohentunut, hyvinvointi kohenee. Ilmastopolitiikka on hyvinvointipolitiikkaa. Tarvitsemme ehdottomasti seuraavaan Euroopan parlamenttiin pro-eurooppalaista päätöksentekoa, demokraattista päätöksentekoa ja pro-ukrainalaista päätöksentekoa, ilmasto- ja luontokatoa ehkäisevää päätöksentekoa. Tämä on meidän kaupunkilaisten ja alueiden komitean etu. Meidän pitää muistaa tulevaisuuskonferenssi, jota tällä kaudella, päättyvällä kaudella on tehty, mihin alueiden komitea on runsaasti osallistunut. Meidän pitää huolehtia läheisyysperiaatteesta. Puheenjohtaja ehdotti, että perustetaan Cohesion Caucus Euroopan parlamenttiin. Minä ehdotan, että perustetaan sen lisäksi Subsidiarity Squad ihmisistä, jotka haluavat pitää Euroopan parlamentissa läheisyysperiaatteen puolta. Vihreät jatkavat työtä demokratian, lähidemokratian eteen ja ilmaston eteen. Me tarvitsemme päätöksiä, jotka edelleen tuovat ilmastonmuutosta kuriin, samalla kun rakennetaan kestävää asumista ja asumista, joka on kaikille ihmisille saavutettavaa. Rakennetaan ihmisille parempia mahdollisuuksia liikkua ja päästöttömästi. Huolehditaan turvallisuudesta, mutta ilman muukalaisvastaisuutta ja vihaa erilaisuutta kohtaan, ja vaan lisää vapauksia, hyvinvointia ja onnellisuutta ihmisille.
Thank you so much. Now this concludes this point of our agenda. Let's move to point number 5. It's an opinion towards a global green deal, harmonizing global frameworks for climate change, biodiversity and sustainable development. There are 2 rapporteurs, Rafał Trzaskowski and Kata Tuto. Mr. Trzaskowski, you have the floor for 3 minutes.
Muito obrigado, Presidente. Throughout the last years, we have made absolutely clear that the success of the European Green Deal hinges on the active involvement of the regions and of the cities, and of course, putting the people at the center of the process. Our role in implementing sustainable practices, reducing carbon emissions, and creating resilient environments is absolutely essential for the well-being of our communities and for increasing the competitiveness of our economies and creating new jobs. All of the challenges and results of climate change do not stop, as we know, at European borders. They are not isolated, but deeply intertwined, exacerbating one another and threatening the very fabric of our existence. The success of these global agreements that are before us depend on the effective implementation at all the levels of governance. Yet, despite our on-the-ground efforts, the inclusion of subnational governments in UN-related talks is at best inconsistent, most importantly lacking solid financial support and transparency. And that's why we propose this opinion, and our goal is to raise the lack of recognition and to highlight the need to enhance synergies between the objectives of the conventions and SDGs. The opinion calls on seeking alliances between UN agenda and the European Green Deal, putting subnational authorities at the core of the whole project. And of course, its aim is to join efforts and multiply the results. We have united our positions on these critical topics into a single document. The opinion mentions the fragmentation of funding streams, which often leads to bureaucratic hurdles and missed opportunities for integrating these actions into the local development plans. We also call for integrated and interoperable monitoring frameworks to simplify the evaluation of process and keep working towards achieving climate and environmental commitments over time. And of course, we talk about addressing socioeconomic disparities exacerbated by the multiple crises. Now, we look ahead at 2024. We see what happened during the European elections. That's why we need to explain better our goals to the people, put them at the center of the process, address their apprehensions, and talk mostly about the added value, not about restrictions. And that's what we are planning to do. And of course, we're trying to synergize all of our efforts at the international fora, the high-level political forum in July, the UN summit on the future in September, and of course, climate COP in COP29 in Azerbaijan and biodiversity COP in Colombia. In order to put us at the center of the process, we are the closest to the people and we know how to address their apprehensions. And of course, we need to involve cities and regions with the aim to permanently bring subnational authorities to the negotiating table, and that's why we need more inclusive and multi-level UN bodies. I'd like to thank you very much for all your contributions and engagement in drafting the opinion. I'm looking forward to hearing your views and continue the process in the Committee of the Regions. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Member Catatuto, you have the floor for 3 minutes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for this opportunity. So what we are doing here, continuing where Rafał stopped, we agreed, not just on the European level, on the global level, on many things we have to do. And this is an agreement of, like, all on climate change, mitigation, adaptation, on stopping biodiversity loss, on disaster risk reduction, on reducing pollution, and on the sustainable development goals, which is about our people, our water, about food security, about wages, about gender equality, about healthy economies. What we are doing here, we are the ones who are implementing. We always talk about that. What we see is, a lot of times, that the problem of the implementation is, why is it? Because we were not there at the designing phase. We see that. We have to implement it, but we have to be also there at the planning phase. We see a lot of money missing. So what we are doing an inventory now of all the things that already been decided. We are the ones who have to cut paths that are real. And there were a lot of comments in the discussion when we were talking about this opinion, about being realistic. But this is what we have to do. This is our job here in Europe, our cities. This is what we are doing in the missions, in the different missions for cities. We try to make this possible and put it as an example on the international level. We do it in the Biodiversity COP. We do it for COP29. This is what we bring. This is why we ask a chair at the table, because we can show examples and we can show that this is something that is a possibility, but we have to work on. We did a lot of small steps forward to have chairs at the tables, but we are not there yet. And we are the ones who have to keep all these plans going, not because of saving the world, but because summer is coming, and summer, for most of us, will be a very, very hard time in the next months. And all our efforts will have to be stabilized for the future. So thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you for all the consultation. Thank you very much for the experts, for the ENVI Commission. It was great to work together with the Mayor of Warsaw, and I hope for a fruitful discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Member Ratilainen, you have the floor for 1 minute.
Kiitos puheenjohtaja, kiitos raportööreille. Tämä on erittäin tärkeä lausunto ja erittäin tärkeä keskustelu. Alueiden komitea osallistuu jo aika moneen hyvin tärkeään globaaliin kokoukseen, missä voimme tuoda meidän eurooppalaisten päättäjien ääntä esiin. Minusta tämä on erittäin hyvä kehitys ja seuraavalla kaudella vielä on tosi tärkeää syventää tätä ja viedä meidän omia ajatuksia, ehdotuksia, esimerkkejä eteenpäin. On erittäin hienoa, että tämä lausunto on tehty ja siihen on sisällytetty monia tärkeitä näkökulmia ja kiitokset myös raportööreille muutosesitysten käsittelystä. Muutamia muutosesityksiä on tänään vielä äänestettävänä ja nostan niistä esiin sen, mitä vihreissä olemme esittäneet, että vielä lisättäisiin näkökulmaa siitä, että EU:n pitää myös toimiessamme tässä kontekstissa parantaa sitä, miten puutumme globaalin eriarvoisuuden vähentämiseen. Ei ole kysymys vain oman esimerkkimme näyttämisestä muille, vaan miten tuemme kansoja, yhteisöjä ja kaupunkeja nousemaan köyhyydestä, eriarvoisuudesta, rakentaen samoin kestävää tulevaisuutta. Kiitos.
Thank you. Now the floor goes to our young elected politician, Céline Gaisman. You have the floor for 1 minute.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, and I would like to thank the community of the region to give the floor to the young European politician. It's a really amazing program, so thank you so much. It's a really important report because the Green Deal is of future and it's cities and regions that are going to implement it. And in my city in Strasbourg, a few weeks ago, we beat the record of rain for the first time in rain more in 1 week than the last 100 years. So it's a proof, it's a scientific proof that climate change is there and that we need to tackle it and to protect biodiversity. So it's very important that the committee of the region aim for a Green Deal to remain a fair and affordable deal. We must support our communities through the implementation of the Green Deal with real issues such as energy bill or housing, as you already initiated, and I think it needs to be continuous in the next mandate. It's crucial to have a just and inclusive ecological transition to engage all population in this Green Deal, and together we can build a sustainable future that leave no one behind. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Member Pavel Grzybowski, you have the floor for 1 minute.
Chciałbym podziękować serdecznie sprawozdawcom za pracę nad tak niezwykłymi, istotnymi wyzwaniami. Samorządy lokalne posiadają szeroką wiedzę kontekstową, co mogłyby przełożyć na bardziej zróżnicowane rozważania w zakresie kształtowania polityki i podejmowania decyzji, zwłaszcza w odniesieniu do celów klimatycznych. Na przykład Europejski Zielony Ład jest podejściem odgórnym, w którym brakuje przejrzystości, wielopoziomowego zaangażowania wielu obywateli. Cele klimatyczne i ambicje środowiskowe muszą uwzględniać poważne zagrożenia i skutki społeczno-gospodarcze oraz wspierać naszych obywateli. Powinny objąć dużo sektorów, a także rolnictwo, a przede wszystkim zapewnić konkurencyjność Europie. Jednym z najtrudniejszych aspektów zielonej transformacji jest to, że nie jest ona wystarczająco sprawiedliwa społecznie i ekonomicznie, a często nie uwzględnia różnorodnych kontekstów i wyzwań poszczególnych regionów. Wynika to między innymi z faktu, że decyzje dotyczące Zielonego Ładu w trakcie kończącej się kadencji zostały podjęte pospiesznie i zwyczajnie były one oparte o realistyczne założenia. Przykładem niech będzie prawo odnowy przyrody. Przeciąży ono gospodarkę, zmniejszy efektywność źródeł energii i jest zagrożeniem dla bezpieczeństwa żywnościowego. Dziękuję.
Thank you so much. Now, member Nilsson, you have the floor for 1 minute.
Mr. President, dear Cork.
Now, now that's the way to do it.
Thank you, Mr. President, Cork colleagues. Vi står inför en avgörande tid av vår planets historia där klimatförändringar och förluster av biologisk mångfald kräver omedelbara åtgärder. Jag önskar att betona behovet av en gemensamt ramverk som binder samman klimatåtgärder och biologisk mångfald. Hållbar utveckling måste genomsyra all vår politik, där investeringar i grön teknologier och ser till att övergången till en grön ekonomi är rättvis och inkluderande. Internationellt samarbete är nyckeln till att hantera dessa globala utmaningar, och vi måste dela kunskap och resurser för att accelerera våra gemensamma framsteg. Låt oss agera nu för en hållbar framtid när mänsklighet och natur samexisterar i harmoni. Tack.
Thank you. Member Komu, you have the floor for one minute.
Kiitos herra puheenjohtaja, kiitos hyvästä mietinnöstä. Eipä olekaan juuri tärkeämpää asiaa kuin ympäristöasiat, jotka ovat olemassaolomme edellytys. Kotikaupunkini Lahti oli Euroopan ympäristöpääkaupunki vuonna 2021, ja täytyy sanoa, että Euroopan unioni antoi meille erittäin paljon voimaa ja mahdollisuuksia ennen ja jälkeen tämän palkintovuoden taistella ilmastonmuutosta vastaan ja tavoitella hiilineutraalisuutta. Meistä entisistä ympäristöpääkaupungeista, meistä on tullut perhe, me pidämme yhä yhteyttä. Ja meitä kannattaa hyödyntää, myös Euroopan alueiden komitean kannattaa meitä ehdottomasti kuunnella ympäristöasioissa myös jatkossa. Kuten äsken kuulimme, ympäristötavoitteiden toimeenpano on todella vaikeaa, ja siksi me tarvitsemme yhä enemmän yhteistyötä niin, että juuri alueita ja kaupunkeja kuunnellaan, koska me toteutamme itse asiat. Meidän omasta kokemuksesta tärkeä on yhteisöllisyys, laajat sidosryhmät ja niiden sitouttaminen. Voima tulee siitä, että sekä asukkaat että yritykset tekevät yhteistyötä. Kiitos.
Thank you. Now, reporter Katatuto, you have the floor for 2 minutes, final remarks.
Yes, thank you very much. I agree. If it's just a top-down approach, it's not possible. All the things we write down, all the ambitions, all the scientific stuff, everything we want to put together, it's extremely hard. It won't work if it's just the top-down stuff. We lack a lot, not just money, but a lot of innovation. What is that we are looking for? What do we believe in? Because we have to try. This is what we're doing. We have to try. If it would be up to me, I would give much more power to cities and regions on this, and more flexibility on this. This is how I always envision it. It's like climbing a mountain. There's not just one way to climb a mountain. It's very hard to climb it, but there are many different paths. And this is what we are doing. We are cutting these different paths, considering where we come from, our power, the speed of our communities, because this is the only way this will be real. So this is what we are striving for. This is what we took as an ambition, European cities, many of our cities with the climate neutral mission, that we will cut this path, and we will show the world that there are many paths, and it is possible, but we have to try, and we have to move on with it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rapporteur Traskowski. You have the floor for final remarks. 2 minutes.
Well, I mean, the most important thing is that we need to react to the reality that surrounds us. And we see the results of the European elections. We see that some people do not understand what actually Green Deal means, and that there are quite a lot of apprehensions. And yes, it is true that sometimes we have the impression that the program was built top-down instead of bottom-up. And that's why the role of the local and regional authorities, it's so absolutely crucial. Because we are the ones who are closest to the people. They ask us questions what to do and how to see the program that is before them. Sometimes they think that this is a program which comes from ideology. They do not understand the jargon, and that's why they have fears which sometimes are founded, especially when it comes to the costs of the undertakings that we undertake. Does that mean that we should think that fighting climate change is not necessary, or that we should throw all of our ambitions through the window? Of course not. But it means that we need to draw the consequences. We need to start explaining to the people what it is all about. We need to start employing the positive language, the added value language, not the language based on restrictions or on shaming. We need to have this positive feedback, which is absolutely important to take the people with us. And I'm absolutely certain that if we are going to talk to the people and explain it to them, that what they see around them when it comes to the changing climate, that this is not happening by itself, show the data, show about the impact on health, show that actually this is a program which can increase the competitiveness of Europe, which can increase the innovation, which can create additional jobs, and which will never leave anyone behind, so that we will fight with the negative consequences, only then we can convince the people that we are going in the right direction. And we are absolutely crucial for that, because we are not far away institutions, but we are actually the people who are close to the people and who know what language to use.
Thank you. Thank you so much.